Normally, I'm not much of a fan of IoT stuff and the smart home stuff. I think it's typically overpriced, kind of gimmicky, and they have a bad propensity for phoning home, which just doesn't sit well with me. But when I saw this pair of Sylvania Bluetooth smart bulbs at my local Dollarama for $5 for the pair of them, I figured I might take a look at them. If nothing else, to see if they're hackable or what their potential is, see how they work. So let's just get into these. Come with a little manual. So it calls itself a 60E19 WBLE. WBLE. So BLE would imply to me that it's Bluetooth Low Energy, maybe. 120 volts, 90 milliamps, 9.5 watts, etc., etc. 800 lumens. I suppose we can just power one up and see what it happens with no programming or anything. Okay, so it's just blinking white on and off, right? Okay, it's stabilized. So it's just basic warm white. It pulses a few times, I guess, because it's not paired with anything. I don't know. Anyway, it's a decent enough warm white light bulb, so just at that, I guess, for $2.50 each for LED light bulbs from a name brand, I guess that's okay, even without the Bluetooth stuff. And let's just see what this manual thing says. Works with Alexa, works with Hey Google. No, ain't gonna do that. I was hoping that it would be just Bluetooth. To troubleshoot pairing issues, download the Sylvania Smart Home app. Okay. Power on the bulb 5 times, and that will put it into pairing mode. Okay. Well, there's their app on the Play Store. Right then. Smart Plus app. Select your home speaker. Nope, nope, nope. No smart speaker. Press here. Let's get... create an account? What? Nope. Right. I'm not going to play with that mode at all. I can't just do it completely offline or outside of their cloud. To hell with it. This is a teardown. Right. That doesn't want to come apart gently, so spudging action. I was hoping with that Bluetooth mode that I could do it without phoning home to the mothership, you know, but it's not to be. So fine, if that's the way they want it, then we'll just take a look inside and maybe de-smartify these if I can. Just turn them into a straight up warm white. That would be useful. Hearing some crunchy noises here. Okay, well, this might take a little bit more effort. There. Okay, well, that wasn't as ugly as I had thought. So what do we have? We've got what looks like the antenna of the wireless module sticking up through a slot in the board. There's the power coming onto the LED board. And we have what looks like 15, 16, 17, 18, 18 LEDs in a circle. Okay, and I don't think there's much else that we can learn without going deeper. So let's go deeper. I guess I'll get this silicone or celastic or schmoo adhesive stuff out of here. That's probably the next move, I think. How does that come out? Okay. Not too hard, I don't think, to get out. Just a matter of kind of scraping away at it in there. Ultimately, I'm going to have to pull that board out, and I'm hoping that stuff is all that's holding it, but never know what these things. They are very much not made to be disassembled. They really don't want you to do it. They don't want to encourage it. There we go. So that's just plugged in through those two pins. So if it's only two pins, this isn't going to be an RGB. It's just going to be one color. So the only smart thing you can do, I guess, is dim it and turn it on off. Okay. There is the rest of the stuff down there. We've got aluminum or aluminized plastic on the inside of there to act, I guess, like a little bit of heat sink coming off of that. Oh, there we go. That wasn't too bad. So there's the hot wire. I probably should just go to school on this one and then try and convert that one if possible, but we'll see. Did that loosen it up enough? Okay, so there's one wire left to the what should be neutral side. Looks like it's over on this side here, but I don't know if I can loosen that up enough to get the wire out from under it. It'd be the ideal solution, but I'm not holding my breath on this part. I mean, I'll give it a try. I'll come back in a minute here if I manage to succeed, or even if I don't. Okay. So that worked. I don't know if I'll be able to put it back together, but we'll try. That might be just in vain. So what do we have here? So we have live and neutral, and that was the neutral that was going to the side, so that's a good start. Either in probably a resistor, fusible resistor. We have a capacitor, C1, across the AC mains. Then we go straight into a bridge rectifier, and then into a whole bunch of other circuitry there. Power supply stuff. Right. Oh, so it looks like it might even be, that's a transformer. So that is an actual switching power supply. Okay. Can we read what the switch mode chip is, which is that guy there? Now, it looks like they've done some partial obliteration on the chip. So even though they made it hard to get into, they've still hidden what the chip is. Fine. Anyway, we've got a couple more diodes, a bunch more diodes after that. A little transistor or possibly voltage regulator there. There's a voltage going out to the LEDs. And there is the controls from the little wireless board. I'm just going to pop one leg of that capacitor off so I can get out of the way so that I can see what the wireless board is. I may put that back on later, I may not. So that wireless module calls itself EWN8250FGT1AA. And there's an FCC ID. Okay. Bluetooth logo.
I am actually surprised. I came up with a hit pretty much first try on Google. That seldom happens on this kind of stuff. Let's see what this thing is. It is a Bluetooth mesh system on chip module. So it's Bluetooth 5 compliant, 2 megabits per second low energy, long range, 125 kbps. Program memory. This is the AA version, so this has got 512k of flash, okay, and 48k of data memory. So you can write protect it. What are the odds that they've write protected it? So it has UART and it has PWM interfaces. Okay, and it has a 10-channel ADC. Transmit up to 10 dBm. Wow. Wide range of temperatures. Cool. It is a 3.3-volt device. Deep sleep, 1 microamp. Seems like a fairly capable little beast. There we go. Okay, physical stuff. We're getting there. Pins. Okay, so away from the antenna is pin 1. Hey, pin definitions. Pin 1 and pin 2 are power. P Pins 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 are PWM. Pin 8 is the ADC. Pin 9 and 10 are UART. Oh, cool. And then a bunch of stuff on how to design around it to avoid interference. Cool. Not a lot of programming information, like literally none. So that's going to make it a little bit difficult to reprogram. I'll spend some other time on it. But right now I want to get back to this set of pinouts. So pins 3 up to 7 are the PWM outputs. Right, that's where I want to look right now.
So pins 1 and 2 are the power. Pin 3 is not connected. Pin 4 is the only other one that looks like it's connected. So that will probably be our PWM output. Goes through a resistor here and ducks under to the power supply chip. Yeah, I guess that makes sense. So if that is the power supply chip that's controlling the output there, then I would think that I just have to, well, I'll pull the module out so that I can play with it, obviously, at a later date. But I should be able to just take the positive voltage, which, what pin was that again? If we look over here, that's pin 1. So if I jump pin 1 over to that, I should be able to get this thing to just light up and be a normal dumb LED light bulb, which I think is a noble goal. Let's give that a shot. First step is going to have to be pulling that module out. I think if I have any chance, I'll have to add some extra flux to my desoldering wick. Just get in there and start pulling the solder out of it. I think that is the best option. There we go. This took a little bit of heat, actually quite a lot of heat, spread around, and I have my module out. So now all I need to do is install a little bodge wire to jump from the positive voltage to that pin there, and we should be in business. Is that going to be good? Maybe. Possibly. I don't know. We'll see. Okay, that should be safe, right? Sure. Which way does this go on here now? Like that, because, yeah. So the positive, it seems to be on that side. I guess I'll just hold this like that. That's a heat sink. It should be safe, I think. Place your bets. Oh, half of the LEDs came on anyway. I'm going to guess that bit of damage right there from disassembly may be related. But that does tell us that this is two series strings in parallel. So that, I guess, is useful information. Power back on again. That's not even all that bright. I wonder what the voltages involved are. So first we'll just check the voltage across the whole thing. 66 volts. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 66 divided by 9 is 7.3 volts per LED, which means that there is two LED chips inside each LED package, right? Three-ish, three and a bit volts each? Sure. And we can probably verify that like this. Yeah, 7.4 volts per LED. I suppose it would be possible to replace that one, but I don't like the idea of soldering on these aluminum-backed circuit boards. There's just, it takes too much heat, it takes too much technique, and these look like the type of surface mount LEDs that have the pads on the back of them. So I'd have to use a heat gun. I don't know. So that does work without the PWM. That's cool. And if I hadn't destroyed that, the answer to my earlier question is, yes, I can convert it to just a normal LED light. Just out of curiosity, how much power are we actually drawing with this thing at half speed? So little, but I can't even measure it. So I think that's enough for today. I learned what I wanted to learn about that. There's nothing fancy about it except for this little module here, and it is bypassable. So now this thing isn't trying to violate my privacy, which is cool. If I can, well, I don't know, getting in there, I had to be pretty abusive with this. I could probably still recrimp it, but I don't know if I'd want to or not. And I do have this little module to do some investigating on. The data sheet didn't have any programming stuff in it other than saying that you can write protect it. It didn't have any programming instructions or API or any of that kind of stuff, so I'd have to do a bit more digging on that. And I may do that as time goes on, but I don't know. There's a pretty good chances that this is going to be something that us hobbyists just cannot mess with. But I might power it up and just see if its UART pins have to say anything. I'll spare you that. That is going to be some long, slow kind of stuff. But if I find anything, I will revisit this in the future. And if not, well, you'll never hear from that again. Still, a fun teardown. Learn something. And I've still got this LED panel that I can use for other things. And I've still got this one that I haven't molested yet. Oh, what do you think? Questions, comments down below. I don't know. We'll see where this goes from here, if anywhere. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later. And because I know somebody's going to ask, this has been O'Hara's Irish Stout in a nitro can, craft brewed in Ireland.